Hey there, everybody. Matt Carter here.
And Jessica Carter from CarterMatt.com.
And I hope you guys are ready for a journey. We're all going to be getting into this together. Find your spot, strap in, get ready. We are heading out into the Expanse. I love outer space stuff.
Yeah, I do too. I only have one tattoo. This is a lot of information here, but it's a space tattoo. I really love space, and I love shows and movies and stuff that take place in space, so it's actually kind of interesting that I haven't gotten into this show until now, but one of our contributors over at Carter Matt has talked about this show nonstop. They've watched it over and over again. They love this show so much. They also recommended Vikings to us a long time ago, and that show was excellent, so it was time to get into the show.
And what we're going to be doing in these videos coming up is we have never seen The Expanse. We have heard a lot about The Expanse. We have been told, like, we're told probably, like, I don't know, dozens of shows every month that are like, okay, you guys need to see this.
And but this is one of those few shows where neither Matt or I have been, like, spoiled on this show. We don't know what happens. Yeah. We don't really know what it's about. We've just been told this show is excellent. You need to watch it. So that's where we're going in. We know that it's based on books. We have not read the books. We haven't read any spoilers.
Yeah.
Very rare. Matt and I get a show. No spoilers. So this is very... So don't come into the comments, please, and spoil it for us. This is very rare for Matt and I.
Yeah, I mean, you can tell me, though, at some point in season two, if Jonathan Banks' character shows up and just starts talking about half measures and, like, oh, I can make so many... See, the thing is, she hasn't seen Better Call Saul, so I have to keep the Better Call Saul mic references to a minimum.
That's right, but I have seen Breaking Bad a whole bunch of times, so I love me some Mike.
Yeah, there's... Okay, but well, before we even talk about the pilot, because that's what this video is going to be all about. We're going to discuss our thoughts on the pilot after watching it and some of what we're enjoying about this show already. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to give us a like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell, just because we're going to be doing a lot of these. This is the plan, and I don't want you guys to miss any of that. Let's start big picture. I mean, The Expanse is the biggest picture possible. Every time I watch one of these shows, it always makes me feel so insignificant because it is just like, look at this huge universe.
Yeah, and it's a really cool concept because we've seen stuff like this on TV before of Cold Wars and a deeper dive into humanity where, you know, you want to hope the best for people, but they're still kind of terrible. And that's sort of what's happening here as well, except it is an expansive universe. And now we have Earth, and now we have Mars, and now we have the Belt. And it's a much bigger picture of everybody still kind of being terrible people, but having that little voice inside of you that tells you to try to do the right thing.
Yeah, I think this show, I mean, I love the pilot a lot. I really, really enjoyed it. I think there was a lot of really cool stuff that transpired throughout it. I think it takes, I mean, at this point, everything is derivative of something. I think that's sort of the reality of where we are in 2019. There are elements of, but luckily, the things that it's deriving itself from are also very, very good things. It does have a little bit of, you know, a classic show like The Next Generation. You could throw in there maybe a little bit of Firefly. You could throw in there almost anything that is space related altogether. The Expanse has some of it, but it does bring that sort of faction element to it that you're describing.
Is this where we start talking about Mass Effect?
I thought about talking about Mass Effect. I have a giant collection of Mass Effect Funkos, both like off camera in here and in the other room. I am a huge Mass Effect guy. There are comparisons that are there. Maybe at some point I will do a giant The Expanse Mass Effect comparison video. Now is not the time for it, but I just really think this was a very put together pilot.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, it was. There's enough loose ends that are still happening because it's just the pilot and they don't want to give you everything, but they gave me enough characters that I'm already invested in, and it's only been the pilot. I'm really invested in Miller. I love that sort of film noir cop who's a little bit dirty, a little bit of a conscience, playing both sides. I love those types of characters that have that inner conflict and different layers to them, because then you don't know what they're going to do. Are they going to do the right thing and make sure that the air filters are clean? Or are they going to do the wrong thing and just take the money and turn a blind eye? You just don't know.
Yeah, it really feels like he is, like, sort of one of these, like, old cop shows, like Columbo or, like, somebody like that who kind of operates with their own agenda. He's like a, you know, a PI on the belt, which is really ironic to me, given that somebody who was featured heavily in this episode is Jay Hernandez, a.k.a. Modern Magnum PI. I believe this was filmed way before he did Magnum PI, but it's still... I love watching shows for the first time and then seeing somebody on it who ended up becoming famous for something else. It's like, oh, hey, it's that guy. But, yeah, I like Miller a lot as a character. I like his hat. I like his attitude. I like the presentation of the belt because it does... It really feels like it's both honoring that noir tradition, like you said.
Yeah, that kind of gritty... under the city's belly kind of feel to it. I really like that.
Yeah, it's like combining that with sort of the classic, whether you want to talk about, you know, the Cantina Bar from Star Wars, or you even want to, they'll throw one Mass Effect reference, Kadara from Mass Effect Andromeda. Like it, well, no matter what you want to do, there's always like this part in this in some sort of space source material that is, okay, here is where all these sort of rebels live, who are kind of the outcasts from the rest of the world and from society, and that is sort of the belt, a place where air and water are valuable commodities.
Yeah, and it's sort of the feel of the working class. They're there to gather resources for the other two sort of richer planets, and which is something that's going on in society. This is a really, in a lot of ways, a really important show that way.
Yeah, and I even like how they were able to cast people to be belters who have this just really strange sort of look to them where they're really, really lanky and have kind of long oblong faces because they're at least, they're throwing in elements of this that scientifically would make sense, that if you're living in this sort of environment, your bone structure, your appearance is obviously going to be different. It's going to be changed. I like that world, but I'm on Team Holden here. I dig Holden. Holden is like the classic... I don't really want to be a hero guy, where you always have this character, and I always like them because they are sort of like the, I'm the reluctant good guy, I don't really want to do this, I just want to, you know, hang out on the Canterbury, do my job, have like, do some business in zero gravity with my girlfriend, like that is clearly this guy's life, and he's digging it, he's down for it.
I think for me, the Holden character, he's going to need to grow on me a little bit because I feel that I've seen this character so many times, the sort of second or third in charge that's kind of laid back and doesn't want to go up the chain. He's just kind of that slacker, but ends up, I don't know, obviously I haven't seen it anymore, but ends up in a position of power, and I've seen it a lot, so... I need that character to grow and get a couple layers for me that maybe I haven't seen or show it in a bit of a different way.
This character is almost always good to me. I'm always in on the like the reluctant hero because it's just usually like, you know what, Holden? I wouldn't want to be XO either. I'm like on your page here. You know, I don't know if I want this responsibility. Look what it did to Mike Ehrman Trout. He's not doing altogether well.
That is true.
Jonathan Banks. I don't know who went to Jonathan Banks and was like...
I don't know how that happened, but good on you. Whoever casted Jonathan Banks, woo, feather in your cap. Holy smokes. It was cool to see him on there.
Yeah, it was cool for like his 2 minutes. And by the way, you know, I think this is what Jonathan Banks decided, that, you know, if his character is going to go crazy, he's going to go very crazy. There are, wait for it, no half measures when it comes to Jonathan Banks playing a crazy person on The Expanse.
If Jonathan Banks comes back... You will probably hear this in every video. I'm just letting you guys know that now.
I do not care. I love Jonathan Banks. So. I will reference Breaking Bad with regularity because he is here. But, you know, this does bring us eventually to, you know, the other part of this that's a pretty common trope in a lot of these sort of genre shows, or really even shows in general, which is the hero's home world or something that's close to the hero gets fundamentally destroyed and... Here we have the Canterbury, which is just kind of just like, poof, the Canterbury tale is over, these people
are... And his woman was in it, so everything that he cared about has been blown up.
Yeah, I mean, doesn't really sound like Holden's future prospects with this girlfriend were altogether great in the first place.
It didn't, but it sounded like he wanted it to be. Yeah. So whether or not she was kind of on the edge of, meh, it'll be fun for when it is, his face told me that he did not want it to just be fun and done. So for him, her getting blown up's not that great.
No, Holden wasn't down for this. And I think... he's going to have a hard time now, I think, moving forward for a number of different reasons.
Well, yeah, because he was the one who decided to actually put this call through, distress call. And now his home is blown up. He's responsible, or he will feel responsible for all of the people that were on there that are gone. That's the thing I'm hoping to see going forward with what I was saying about those layers about Holden of how this is going to change him. Because even though... it getting blown up is not his fault. He's going to see that chain, that it is his fault.
I think we'll get there. I mean, I'm even though I'm on board, I still want to see him evolve. If he's this same person exactly at the start of season 2, I don't know if I'll be thrilled with that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm thrilled with, though? I really like Naomi. It's not
okay, I'm all on board with Naomi. She feels like somebody who's... yeah, we did get to see, like, a lot of her, but she seems like somebody who, like Miller, can be on both sides of the coin, where it could be very strong and like, man, we really shouldn't have taken that call. Don't tell anybody that you did this because this wasn't right. You know, and that's a pretty interesting moral dilemma that she had chosen the side to leave this person to their demise, if that was what it could have been.
Yeah, and I think we've seen at least somewhat of, like, where her head is at, but I think more than anything else, she just feels like someone I would want to, like, you know, be around, and just sort of, she has good energy, and I think sometimes when you're watching a show for the first time, like, you have to make really quick judgment calls on people because it's sort of like...
like I've made on Holden.
Yeah, it's like...
I'm sorry, Holden. We'll see. We'll see how you turn out for me.
It's okay, Holden. You can just come and hang out with me. You can tell me about all your rogue space adventures and how you didn't want to be XO and Jonathan Banks screwed you over. It's all okay. They're very screwed over now, though. Like, that is pretty much official.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that I want to talk about is the Julie of it all. So we watched this episode with the subtitles on because I can't hear very well out of my left ear. So I usually watch things with subtitles on.
Yeah.
So when that distress call came in, it actually told me that the distress call was Julie.
Yeah.
And this connects to Miller's case where he was told that he needs to find this rich couple's daughter named Julie who's gone off and is like protesting and being, you know, crazy young person, as many of us were, where you're going off to college or going off on your own and you think you can make that difference, and you all of a sudden you're in protest and you're doing things and you feel that you can make that difference. So when that distress call came in, it was interesting because I really wasn't sure at first if it was she's in distress or this theory that I came up with that may be way off, and I don't know if it's right or not. But after seeing the different clues that, you know, she's missing, her parents can't find her, she comes from a well-off family, she's a young person who's now been seen sort of protesting and getting really involved in stuff, and we know that the people that there are people on the belt, the OPA, I think is what they're called, sort of this organization that's trying to make better conditions for people on the belt and, you know, maybe making things a little bit better, helping with air, helping with water, all that sort of stuff. Maybe she is connected in some way of making a difference. So when that stress call came in and everyone on the crew was like, oh, it's a pirate bait, they're trying to bait us in and whatever. And then it turned out, that seems to be what was going on to me, that I was wondering if Julie is part of this whole thing now, that maybe it was a plant. Maybe she is part of trying to make some sort of a difference and because there it feels like Earth and Mars, or everyone sort of feels like this OPA are almost like terrorists, and that it's something worse and bigger than it is, because they're killing people and they're going to extreme measures to get a point across. Okay, maybe I'm crazy.
Well, this is my feeling on things like this. Everything is connected. Everything on a show like this. This is the first episode.
Maybe the OPA picked her up and are holding her prisoner or making her do something.
Well, I think there's very well a clear connection between the OPA, between her, between everything that's going on with the rescue operation. We saw very deliberate things in a pilot that is only about 45 minutes long.
Yeah.
This was not an extremely long pilot. I think it's pretty clear to me that everything within this episode is set up to eventually collide with one another. So, I mean,
It just felt like that video of her, like, protesting or whatever it was she was doing in that video was obviously deliberate. Everything is deliberate. But it felt like, for me, the clue or the connection that something else is happening here. That either maybe she's been kidnapped because she's being loud about things, or that she's joined up with some sort of group to try to make a difference.
Well, I think a lot of it may just stem from the fact if she's coming from wealthy family, this happens with a lot of people, they're sort of like, you know what? I don't want to be known forever for just being the son or the daughter of this other person. It's like the celebrity kid going on The Masked Singer, where you want to be anonymous and you want to have something that is clearly your own. And then at the end of it, maybe they discover who you really are.
Yeah.
And maybe that's sort of where we're going with this story. But, you know, guess what? We have a whole season to figure this out, let alone a couple
others. And we haven't even talked yet about Earth. And I want to say her name is Christian.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I'm not sure. That's what I'm going with right now. If I've mispronounced it, leave it in the comments below and tell me how to pronounce it. I've only watched this one episode. I've barely seen this character, and I am the most interested in this character. I find it really interesting to have a character who's sort of this political figure, but is also completely aware of people being tortured for information and... It's very, because normally you get on shows people who are political and that's kind of only where they are. And then they have other people doing torturing or you know, whatever they have to do to get information out of people. And you don't always see the political person coming into the cell and ordering what the next bout of torture will be to get the information. And, oh, call me in 10 hours if he's still alive. That's so cool. I really am interested in this character to see where this goes with her.
I am really fascinated about that. I'm also really fascinated about the fact that her grandkid can, like, throw things in a house and she just doesn't care at all. And she's just like, oh, whatever.
Well, that was also, again, really interesting, that sort of different positions of seeing her as a family person, as a grandma, that, you know, it's okay to wreck the mirror and be ridiculous and rambunctious in the house and, ha-ha, my family, and then... Oh, yeah, just give him 10 more hours on this torture chamber and call me if he's alive. I was just like, whoa.
Well,
there is a cold space in your heart.
Well, I think this is the real explanation for this, is that she probably deals with people like this on occasion. I can't imagine this is the first time she's dealt with somebody if she's saying something like that.
No.
I think she's probably like, you know what? Kid throwing stuff around in my place. Probably very, very down here on the priority list, when for all of us, it's probably, like, way up here. And then, like, for her way up here, like, beyond the reaches of the screen is probably what she's got going down with these interrogation scenes. But, you know, we have made it through episode one of The Expanse.
Great episode. Very excited about this
journey.
This whole journey, yeah.
And, so, I mean, if you guys have seen more of it, please don't spoil it for us. We want you to be here along the way. So, share your thoughts, or if it's been a while since you've seen the pilot, share your memories of watching it, your first impressions, what you enjoyed the most about it. Or if there's specific things that you want us to look forward to that are kind of teaser-ish and not spoilery.
Not too spoilery, but things that, we would like to look forward to. Just leave it in the comments.
Yeah, and if you enjoyed this video, give us a like, subscribe, and you can support us further by checking that link in the description to the Cartomat store, and we'll see you here next time.